Commodore 64, check. EEPROM programmer, check. PCB, check. Pi Zero, check. A bunch of components, check. Let's get started. In this video, we're going to look at the build and use of this. This is a Pi 15410 hat. It is a cycle exact emulation of a Commodore 1541 floppy disk drive. This hat also includes a built-in EPIX fastload utility. Before we jump into the build, I'm going to take a moment to thank PCBWay for sending me this PCB. Need your own PCBs manufacturing? Then head on over to PCBWay.com. They also have a shared projects section where you can purchase PCBs for great projects such as the Pi 1541 hat in this video. Right, onto the build. The values of each component are silkscreened onto the PCB, so just insert the components as per the labelling. Pay attention to the LED, ICs, logic converter, and the display, as these must be inserted the correct way around. Also note that the 40-pin connector must be soldered into place before the display. Talking of the display, when you are ready to install it, pay attention to the pinouts on your particular display. There are some instructions on the PCB that direct you to short either the VCC pads or the GND pads, depending on the pin order of your display. I opted for a JST header with wires already crimped in place. This is because I don't have a crimp tool to do it myself. Once built, it's time to program the EEPROM. So head on over to the PCBWay project page, the link is in the description, and download this zip file containing the binaries for the EEPROM. This project is compatible with several EEPROMs. I'm using the 27C256R, so I'll need the 27256.bin file. Next, open up your favourite EEPROM programming application and ensure that you select the correct version of EEPROM that you have. So here I must select the AT27C256R, and since it is a through-hole chip, the package is DIP28. Then open the correct bin file for your EEPROM, and I'm assuming that you've already extracted the zip file before doing this. If you haven't already, connect your EEPROM programmer to your computer and insert the blank EEPROM, paying attention to the orientation. Then, in the app that I'm using to program the EEPROM, I select Device and then Program. As a final check, the app shows me which way the EEPROM should be inserted into the programmer. Mine is correctly inserted, so I'm good to go. Programming took just under 15 seconds and I received a success message. Fantastic! So now, remove the EEPROM from the programmer and insert into the socket on the PCB. Note that the legs on many new chips are often slightly angled outwards, so they won't actually fit into the chip holder very easily. If this is the case, bend the legs slightly by placing the chip on a hard surface like this and gently applying pressure as you rotate the chip. The last thing to do is remove the protective film on the OLED display. Wait for it, wait for it. Yes, that felt good. Now we need to copy the necessary files to the microSD card in order for the Pi Zero to run and emulate the Commodore 1541 floppy disk drive. So head on over to the project page on PCBWay.com and scroll down and click this link. This website is by the designer of the Pi 1541, so thank you, Steve, for such a great piece of software and keeping my childhood memories alive by allowing me to run all of my favourite games on my Commodore 64. Scroll down a bit and here you can give Steve some support and keep his project alive. The software we need to download is here, and we also need the latest kernel image for the Pi Zero. Next, keep scrolling down to the setup section. The first thing is to format your microSD card to FAT32, then download the Pi firmware. Once downloaded, extract the zip file. And while I'm in my downloads folder, I'll extract the other two downloads. So now we need to copy these three files from the firmware folder onto the root folder of the microSD card. So, selecting each of the three files, I'll copy and paste them onto my microSD card. Next, I need to copy the extracted Pi 1541 zip file contents onto the root folder of the microSD card. I'm going to delete this kernel image file since I need to use the version that I downloaded for the Pi Zero. Here's the version I need, so I'll copy this to the root folder of the microSD card. Then you'll need to follow this link and download Vice. Then, from within the folder structure of the downloaded files, locate the file DOS1541. I already have that file in my clipboard, so I'll just paste it onto the microSD card now. You'll need to copy any Commodore 64 floppy disk images that you wish to use into the 1541 folder. There are many places to obtain these, and there is even a thriving C64 development community about today. And they're still releasing brand new games for the Commodore 64. We now only need to edit two config files and then we'll be good to go. Open the config.txt file and copy these lines. I've put them in the description so you can simply copy and paste them. Here, we're overclocking the Pi Zero since it's not as powerful as the Pi that I used in a previous video for a similar project. Save and exit the config file. Then, open the options text file. We're going to change this line to equals 0. And scroll down a little more, and the type of OLED display I am using is this top one, so I'll uncomment out that line. Then scroll down a little further and uncomment out this line so that it reads quick boot equals 1. Save and close the file. Eject the micro SD card, insert into the Pi Zero, and you're good to go. After having inspected the PCB for shorts and making sure all components are inserted the correct way around, it's time to plug it into the Commodore 64. The C64 must be powered off when you do this. Then connect the lead to the serial port. Next is the moment of truth, powering on the machine. Yes, it works, and I didn't kill anything. You can see that the C64 boots almost instantly, and the EPYX fastload is already loaded, as evident by the word fastload near the top left of the display. The Pi Zero takes a few moments longer to boot, and when it has, the OLED display comes to life. These buttons are used to browse the software on the SD card, so I'm going to select the disk image for Doc Cosmos. The EPYX fastload includes a shortcut key combination to load software. Press the Commodore key and run stop to load the game. The cartridge has a built-in reset which resets the Commodore 64, not the Pi Zero. The EPYX fastload also contains some disk utilities, which can be accessed by typing the British pound symbol. These are then menu driven, so I can view the directory contents of my floppy disk image, for example. So to sum up, a great little budget project to enhance your Commodore 64. And as a final note, if you've access to a 3D printer, then check out this pre-designed case, simply download and print.